Welcome back, children. And last session we understood about the properties of paramagnetic materials and diamagnetic materials. And at the end I told how on temperature the paramagnetic nature will be depends. That we are covering now. So see this one. Usually the magnetic susceptibility of the paramagnetic materials, I told it will be positive and it will be greater than the 1, because I equals to it will be greater than 1. And what about the relative permeability? It is also positive and it is greater than 1. And see this one. For in paramagnetic materials, the intensity of magnetization is directly proportional to external magnetic field intensity, and it is inversely proportional to the temperature, because more the temperature, then the randomness nature of magnetic atoms that will be increases. Therefore, when the temperature is more, the net magnetic moment will be decreases. Therefore, the intensity of magnetization and temperature both will be inversely proportional to each other. By combining this, what I could write, I equals to C into H divided by T, where C is nothing but Q is constant. And from here, what is going to be the intensity of magnetization by field intensity? It is nothing but magnetic susceptibility. So the magnetic susceptibility equals to C by T. This is called as a Curie's law. According to Curie's law, the magnetic susceptibility of a paramagnetic material is inversely proportional to temperature. So if we plot the graph for the temperature versus magnetic susceptibility, then I will have the nature like rectangular hyperbola. This is a rectangular hyperbola. In this way, the nature will be. And if you plot the intensity of magnetization versus the field intensity, and for a paramagnetic material, it will be a straight line where the slope will give you magnetic susceptibility. This is what the nature of the paramagnetic material and how it depends upon the temperature and intensity of magnetization, how it varies with the magnetic field intensity. That's the end of the paramagnetic materials. Well, now let us step into the last and important kind of magnetic material, that is ferromagnetic material, that we will see now. The ferromagnetic material. Ferromagnetic materials are nothing but the magnetic materials which will induce large amount of magnetic field when they kept inside external magnetic field. So the ferromagnetic materials will attain a large amount of magnetic property. A large amount of magnetic property when you kept inside the external magnetic field. Now let us know what is the reason behind this ferromagnetic nature. Actually, just like a paramagnetic material, in ferromagnetic materials also the tiny atom magnets will be there. But unlike the paramagnetic materials, in case of ferromagnetic material, those tiny atoms, the tiny atomic magnets, they will be grouped together to form a domains. That means the nature, if the material, if we see, then we will have a different regions which will have a different amount of G. All the tiny magnetic moments here will be aligned in one direction. These are will be called as a domains. These are called as a domains. At any before going to keep in an external field, these domains, net magnetic moment, total vectorial sum will become zero. Therefore, ferromagnetic materials do not exhibit the magnetic property unless you keep in external magnetic field. Now, if you keep this ferromagnetic specimen, which will have the large magnetic moments which are aligned in different direction, then what will happen? All these magnetic alignments, I mean, these small domains will try to align in single direction, so that the large amount of magnetic moment will be develops in one direction. This is what will be happen for a ferromagnetic material when you keep inside the external strong magnetic field. Now, unlike the paramagnetic and the diamagnetic materials, these materials, ferromagnetic materials, do not lose their magnetic property when you turn off external magnetic field. Why? Because these are all aligned in one direction, such that they will have a large amount of magnetic moment which do not immediately fall back to zero when you drop, when you switch off the external magnetic field. This is what will be happening. Now, what will be the nature, what will be the properties of ferromagnetic materials? The properties are nothing but, so if you keep the ferromagnetic material specimen inside the uniform magnetic field, then almost all the field lines will be attracted into the specimen. There will be hardly no magnetic lines of force are lying outside the specimen. There will be no magnetic field lines of force lying outside the specimen. All the field lines will be attracted into the material, and for this the susceptibility will be high. It will be high and also positive. The relative permittivity will be also high, and so this susceptibility will be in the order of around 10^4. The susceptibility will be in the order of around 10^4. Therefore, the relative permittivity also very, very high. Now, for this, what will be the nature? How it will depend upon temperature? For a ferromagnetic materials, we can write like this. For a ferromagnetic materials, the susceptibility could be written as C divided by T minus T prime. This is called as the modified Curie's law. Modified Curie's law for ferromagnetic material. Ferromagnetic materials. And here C is nothing but Curie constant, and T prime is nothing but Curie's temperature. Therefore, what will be happen for ferromagnetic materials when you raise the temperature? When we raise the temperature, then up to certain limit, it will keep on exhibit the ferromagnetic nature only. And beyond the temperature limit, then it immediately show the completely paramagnetic nature. So beyond this Curie temperature, that particular temperature at which the ferromagnetic material is changing into paramagnetic material will be called as a Curie temperature. At the Curie temperature, what will be happen? All this domain nature will be collapses. That domain nature will be completely collapses in such a way that any atomic magnets, now they are free to have their own alignment because of rise of temperature. So with the rise of temperature, all that alignments will be randomly changes such that the net magnetic moment will be less than the total magnetic moment. Hence, the ferromagnetic material will show now paramagnetic nature. So here T prime is nothing but Curie temperature. Above the Curie temperature, the ferromagnetic material will be showing the property of paramagnetic material, and below the Curie temperature, the ferromagnetic material will still retain with its ferromagnetic nature. This is what called the modified Curie's law for ferromagnetic materials. And if we plot intensity of magnetization versus magnetic field intensity, then the nature will be like this. The graph will be like this. And there is no particular graph for how the susceptibility is varies with the temperature. Okay, that's why I am not able to draw here. So this, I think you understood, this is what called modified Curie's law for ferromagnetic material. And now let us look into the very, very important concept related with the ferromagnetic material, that is hysteresis curve or hysteresis graph, or sometimes it is also called as hysteresis loop, which is the characteristic property of ferromagnetic materials. Now we will look into that. What is the meaning of hysteresis? Hysteresis is nothing but a word which will be given to the process when something is lagging behind the another one. So why I am telling like that, we will understand. The ferromagnetic materials hysteresis curve. Let us understand hysteresis curve. Let us look into this. If we plot the graph for magnetizing field intensity versus intensity of magnetization. Now, for a ferromagnetic material, I'm telling, for a ferromagnetic material, if we plot the graph for intensity of magnetizing field versus the intensity of magnetization, the graph will be shown like this. At the very beginning, at the point O, which is nothing but origin, when the field intensity is zero, the intensity of magnetization also zero. Now, with the increase of magnetizing field intensity, the intensity of magnetization also slowly increases non-linearly, and it will attain some constant and maximum value. Whenever, when you keep on increasing the magnetizing field intensity, the intensity of magnetization do not increases linearly. It will increases non-linearly, such that at particular point of magnetizing field intensity, this intensity of magnetization will become maximum. And this maximum value is also called as a saturation value. Saturation value. So at the saturation value, the maximum extent of magnetization could be happen, and beyond the increase of magnetizing field intensity, there will be no further increase of magnetization. It will be the highest value and it is a constant. So this what let me call as a point A. Now from here to here, I have drawn from here to from the origin, magnetizing field intensity increases, and accordingly intensity of magnetization also varies along with this graph. Now, if we start decreasing the magnetizing field intensity, then what will happen? So, as we expected, magnetizing intensity of magnetization do not follow the same path as previously it has followed. It will follow some new path, such that even though the field intensity is zero, here the field intensity is zero, but intensity of magnetization is not equals to zero. So the amount of intensity of magnetization, the amount of magnetization left over in the space, left over in the specimen, even after external magnetic field intensity is zero, will be called as a residual magnetization or retentivity. So this amount OB, the amount OB is called as what? Residual magnetization. Residual magnetization, or it is also called as a retentivity. Now, to decrease, to make this residual magnetization come down to zero, we have to apply the amount of magnetizing field intensity in the opposite direction. Here and now it is positive, and that positive value I am decreasing. Now here I am applying in the opposite direction. Therefore, further if I decrease the magnetizing field intensity in the opposite direction at particular value of magnetizing field intensity, the magnetization, intensity of magnetization completely becomes zero. So here intensity of magnetization becomes zero, H will not be equals to zero. So the amount of magnetizing field intensity which is making the magnetization come down to zero will be called as a coercivity or coercive force. Shall I call this point as a C? So now the point OC will be called as what? Coercive force or coercivity. Coercivity. So the amount of opposite magnetic field intensity or amount of the negative magnetic field intensity which will make the object to come down its residual magnetization to zero will make that will be called as a coercive force or coercivity. And further, if you continue to increase the magnetizing field intensity in the same opposite direction, then the field, the intensity of magnetization will be again goes down for the maximum value, but in the opposite side. So it will be the saturation here. In the same way, on the other side also, it will have a maximum saturation. Now further, if you increase the positive value again, then again it will follow some different loop like this. Again, it will follow some different loop like this. And this is what called as a hysteresis curve. And here, the magnetization and magnetic field intensity do not follow the same path. Always, one is lagging behind another one. So this is what called as a hysteresis. Hysteresis in the sense, hysteresis curve, the meaning of hysteresis curve is nothing but when something is lagging behind the another one, and if that is shown on the graph, that will be called as a hysteresis curve. Here the hysteresis process is taking place between the intensity of magnetization and the field intensity. Here important terms what you need to remember is what is the meaning of saturation value, and this is called as a positive saturation, it is called as a negative saturation. Negative saturation in the sense when we make the maximum negative field intensity, we got the maximum magnetization in the opposite direction, and this is what called as a negative saturation, this is called as a positive saturation. And two more important terms here what we need to understand, OB and OC. OB is nothing but the residual magnetism, or it will be also called as a retentivity. And what is the meaning of OC? OC is nothing but coercive force or coercivity. And let me try to plot the hysteresis graph for two different materials called soft iron and iron. Soft iron and steel. So let me try to plot with the help of them. We are going to understand two important things. Let me try to plot them first. So if we have the hysteresis graph that are drawn for two different materials, one is called soft iron, another one is a steel, the nature will be like this. So this is the plot, the hysteresis of the drawn for the steel material, and this is the hysteresis graph that drawn for soft iron materials, soft iron material. And this, as usual, is the field intensity versus intensity of magnetization graph. And here, what you can notice, for a soft iron material, this, which is nothing but the reactivity, is more, the coercivity is less. Whereas for the steel material, the reactivity is less and coercivity is more. Actually, the difference between them, as is shown in this graph, it is not that much large, that much large difference. It will be smaller differences only. So for the graph, it may be in this graph, seemingly it is like a high and low value, but there will be no major difference between the reactivity left out with soft iron and steel material. A very small difference only will be there. And one more interesting thing here is what? The coercivity is more for steel, the coercivity is less for soft iron. That we have to remember. And what is the importance of these graphs? Since for a soft iron, the retentivity, the coercivity is less, this soft iron will be usually used for, I mean, it will be applicable in case of for preparing the course of, these will be used for preparing the course of transformers, electromagnets, galvanometer, transformer, galvanometer, generator. So, since for soft iron materials, this coercivity is less and they will be used for the course of transformers, galvanometer and generator, and they will be also used in electromagnets. And here, what is the important thing that we need to understand regarding this hysteresis loop is nothing but the area under hysteresis loop is directly gives you the amount of heat energy. Amount of heat energy lost. The amount of heat energy. If the area under the hysteresis loop is more, the amount of heat energy lost whenever it is undergoing the magnetization and demagnetization, it will be less. So if it is more, the amount of heat energy will be more. Amount of heat energy lost will be more. If it is, the area is less, the amount of heat energy lost during the one magnetization and demagnetization completed curve will be less. Now, usually for a soft iron, this area will be less, and for steel, it will be more. For steel, it will be more. For soft iron, it will be less. Therefore, these will be, actually these course of transformer, galvanometer and electromagnets require high permeability, susceptibility, the retentivity and low value of coercivity. And low value of loss of energy. So these are all materials. They should have some common property. What is that? They should have a high values. Whatever the material I am using for their cores, the preparation of transformer core, galvanometer core, or for preparing the electromagnets, they should have these two properties. What are they? They should have a high value of permeability, susceptibility and retentivity, and low value of coercivity and loss of energy. And these are all characteristics that will be satisfied by soft iron materials. That's why they will be widely used for preparing all these materials. And where will this steel material? The steel material will be widely used in preparing the permanent magnets. The permanent magnets are prepared by using the steel materials. Just because of the reason, they have, the steel materials we have the high value of retained and high value of the coercivity also. So these permanent magnets should have the properties. So just like here I have written some properties like that, the permanent magnets also should have some properties. What are they? They should be prepared with the materials of high permeability, high coercivity and high value of retentivity. They should be prepared with high permeability material, high coercivity and high retentivity material, which are all will be satisfied by the property by the steel materials, and that's why they will be widely used. And this what about the hysteresis curve and the different materials which could be prepared by the soft iron and steel. And with this, the end of the magnetism topic, and magnetism which is nothing but the magnetic materials we have understood today's lesson. So with this it will be over. In the next lesson we are going to, in the next session we are going to start with the the earth magnetic property, the terrestrial magnetism. That is the last topic, last subtopic for the magnetism. Thank you.